Now, Colonel Steve, Colonel Steve, the DMI, the acting DMI, in that year, at that particular time, 1996, when we were on official assignment to Cameroon, Sierra Leone, thank you very much, I'm sorry, to Sierra Leone, authorized in writing, and gave you 3 AK-47 rifles and some ammunition for that assignment.
Which one?
To Sierra Leone.
I was in Sierra Leone so many times. First, to investigate a coup.
I'm talking about 2nd June.
Oh, 2nd June.
Yes.
Okay, yes. June. I was undercover operations commander, task force.
And you duly authorized.
Operations sand. Yes,
you
indeed.
You signed.
Yes, indeed, I signed.
Thank you very much. Did you return the weapons as required by army regulations to the arms store by the time you came back from Sierra Leone?
No.
Thank you very much. Colonel Majeyogbe,
no, excuse
me,
please.
I put it to you.
Before you put it,
let me explain.
I
put it to you that you illegally kept those arms and ammunition you brought back from Sierra Leone.
Good.
You knew the right process.
Thank you.
To return it back to the army. To the arms store in the army, you did not do it.
Good.
You have said you
Counsel, I do not blame you. So let me explain now. I have a right
to
explain.
You have answered. No explanation. You have said yes.
My lord, can the commission help me? You ask a question. Let me answer
did
the
you
question.
Get, I'm asking
so
you.
So what happened was
we
this.
We have something called re-examination.
Okay.
In this episode, Colonel Olanipekun Majeyogbe is called to the witness box to testify in the Chuma and Zerbi petition. Colonel Majeyogbe was born on the 29th of March 1951 in Osun State. He was one of the senior officers serving with the military intelligence unit at the time when the petitioner was arrested and detained by the military. According to the former DMI Colonel Steve Idere's testimony, Colonel Majeyogbe was complicit in the setup of Chuma and Zerbi, when explosives and other sophisticated weapons were stolen from the DMI and planted at Nzerbi's compound in Hiala at the behest of his infamous benefactor, Victor Ezeogo Okafo. Colonel Idehere also accused Majeyogbe of many other infractions, including receiving bribes and participating in illegal duty, much to the dismay of Majeyogbe. In this episode, Colonel Majeyogbe is given the opportunity to clear his name and set the record straight against Colonel Idehere's many allegations. He also uses the opportunity to protest the malicious manner in which he was retired from the army by the former Chief of Army Staff, General Ishaya Bamei. Colonel Majeyogbe's wit and antics makes this episode one of the more memorable sessions. He passed away on the 25th of November 2020 at the age of 69. If you enjoy our content, don't forget to like, subscribe, and share. And we wish you a very prosperous new year in 2024.
At the last adjournment, I did ask you this question. Were you given any monetary consideration for the operation in Iyala?
No, my lord.
There was this allegation against you that for the arrest of Chief Chuma Nzeribe, one Chief Ezeogo gave you a BMW car as compensation. What do you have to say concerning this?
That is absolutely incorrect. And I'd like to explain, my lord. In 1997, the same Colonel Idehere, self-appointed counsel to General Abubakar, made this same allegation, and it was thoroughly investigated and found to be false. And I have come today with all the documents relating to that car. That car was purchased.
All right, tender them.
Excuse me, let him have a look at this.
Yes, my lord. There are 3 letters which were written by Dr. Olabimi Majeyogbe from Germany concerning the car. I told him I wanted the car, and he wrote 3 letters.
I seek to tender the letters, my lord, and the car particulars.
Counsel, can I make
Don't mark it. Let's see what it is. You talked about, I think, was allegation was investigated. What is this?
There were letters written in 1996 concerning...
I'm talking about investigation. He said the allegation was investigated and found to be wrong.
With due respect, sir, it was alleged.
I don't say you shouldn't tender it, but what about the investigation? Was there any investigation?
Well, I don't know anything concerning
that. He said so just now. The allegation was investigated and was found to be wrong.
My lord, can I answer the question? Yes. The counsel doesn't know.
I don't know whether investigation is what we know investigation to be.
This is what I'd like to explain, sir.
It was investigated.
It was thoroughly investigated
by SIT.
By security group, Nigerian Army Intelligence Corps.
And they issued their report.
A report was issued which I read thoroughly.
Where is the report?
Good. The Director of Military Intelligence has that report. And I'd like to explain, sir.
Hold it. You are coming here to defend allegation against you.
Yes, sir.
Which was investigated.
Yes, sir.
You were cleared.
Yes, sir.
The report exists.
Yes, sir.
Why didn't you bring it along?
Thank you very much, sir. For over 20 years, I trained security men in this country not to remove official documents. Because there are 3 principles that I taught them in 20 years.
Don't go on preaching.
Yes,
where
sir.
Is the report?
The report is with the Director of Military Intelligence.
He refused to give you a copy.
I did not ask because I'm not entitled to it.
You can go on. With due respect, my lord, I seek to tender the...
Please let the commission...
Excuse me. I think we are treading on very... Can you just go back to the point you were making before?
Yes, sir.
Please, just for the point,
sir,
of explanation.
For over 20 years, I trained people in Army Intelligence, Navy Intelligence, Air Intelligence, SSS, Prisons, Customs, Nigeria Police, on the handling of official documents. And I always said to them, even upon the pain of death, do not remove official documents. So when the thing was investigated, they showed it to me and cleared me. When this Konaidehen started the same problem again, it would have been easy to say, give me the document. The first principle on document security is the need to know. Second principle, the need to hold. Third principle, the need to take away. I did not have any need to touch those documents because Idehere was accusing me. If I did that, the federal government had the right to prosecute me, and nobody will ever trust me with any documents anymore. The Director of Military Intelligence is alive and well. The president was here. He can be asked to come and present that document officially. Thank you, sir.
When did you call me about this car?
So I wrote to my uncle, Dr. Ola Bimi Majeyogbe, a brain surgeon in Germany, and he wrote 3 letters.
Before you go on, we talk about the federal government prosecuting you. Section 10 of the law under which we are set up says, any person who, after service on him of a summons to attend as a witness, or to produce a book, document, or any other thing, and notwithstanding any duty of secrecy, however imposed. So if you tell them that under this section, if you don't produce this thing, you may go to prison, they'll give you a copy.
That
they
is
don't
true,
say
sir.
You should extract it from the file. No, yes. They give you a copy,
that
certified
is true,
true copy. So don't waive this question of secrecy to us. It doesn't mean anything here.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. But the Director of Military Intelligence is better placed to present it officially. Then there is no doubt at all. It's better to come from the source.
When did you acquire this car? Which year?
1996.
When was the operation at Iala carried out?
1997.
Do you have particulars of the car?
Yes, I do. Indeed, my lord, I hope the commission will be patient with me. I am suddenly so upset about this allegation that I would rather hand in the original documents of the car
and also submit the car as exhibit so that I can have peace. Konedere has done it before. He will accuse me again. So I like to hand in the original papers and then drive the car from Lagos so that anybody...
Of which car?
Of the car that I was
which
alleged...
Car?
BMW that I was alleged to have been given as bribe.
Did he give the chassis number?
Everything is here, sir.
No. The one he said was given to you. What was the chassis number?
Well, I don't know. He didn't talk about that.
There are so many BMWs.
Yes, sir.
It's not only one.
Yes. That is true. Well, that is
help
true,
us. It's neither here nor there.
Yes.
Unless you have the chassis number.
Yes, sir.
And the, what do you call the other number?
Engine and serial number.
Yes, the particular so that we can compare.
Yes.
There may be three or four types of BAW
yes,
at the same time.
But he is here.
Giving
yes,
us
sir.
One doesn't help us. Well, we may ask.
Sorry. Just on a light anonym, if you are ready to dispose of the car, you can bring it. We'll give it to somebody who was detained in military intelligence.
Yes, sir.
And has no car now.
Yes, sir.
But I think on a more serious note, if it were possible for military intelligence, because I can understand what you're saying, that may, perhaps the onus is on us to ask military intelligence to produce the report, since, as you said, you would be violating the principle on which you have taught others, since you said it was under pain of death. I take it that you would have been ready to go to prison rather than...
Absolutely,
so
sir.
Perhaps the next thing is, if we want the report, we'll have to approach military intelligence directly. But meanwhile, as I said, if you want to tender the car to us, you can do that. I'm sure there are quite a lot of victims of military excesses that will be ready to use the car while the case is...
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, sir. But can I make a comment, please? My Lord, I had asked counsel to give me the opportunity to make an apology at the beginning. I want to make an apology, sir, at the beginning.
Apology for whom? To whom?
During the last sitting, I referred to Colonel Edehere as somebody from Wari. I have since been corrected by the good people of Delta State that is not from Wari. That
what's the apology then?
The apology is this. I make a wrong statement. I thought he is from Wari because he used to boast that he's a Wari boy. The people of Delta have said, please don't associate us
along
with
your evidence.
Yes, thank you very much, sir.
Colonel, were you at any time arrested in connection with the operation in Iala?
Yes, indeed. I was arrested.
When?
About the 27th, 28th of July 1997, I was in Kaduna as a team leader to conduct examinations for young officers who are going from the rank of captain to major. Usually, the chief of army staff will select people to go and conduct the exam. I was selected by Lieutenant General Ishaya Bamei to lead a team in that exam. And it was at the venue that I was picked up by gunmen sent after me by Colonel Idehere.
On 27th?
About the 27th, 28th.
Okay.
28th, 29th, yes.
Were you at any time subjected to investigation?
Yes.
This operation?
Yes, the matter was investigated by the commanding officer, Security Group Nigerian Army Intelligence Corps.
Can you briefly mention the names of those that were investigated with you and the procedure, briefly?
Yes, Colonel Stephen Idehere was invited for questioning. I was invited for questioning. Captain F.B.Y. Dulaha was invited for questioning. And Lance Corporal Abudime, everybody who took orders from me was invited, and we're all questioned.
What was the outcome of the investigation?
My Lord, it was a long report, 10 pages, in which they established the facts of what happened. I remember clearly that it was about paragraph 22, which said this operation was authorized, funded, and directed by the acting DMI.
Who was acting DMI?
Colonel S.M. Idehere.
It was also alleged that you wrote Colonel Sabo's paper at War College.
I have already answered this question. I did not write.
You've already answered this on record, we know. He did not, he said.
Yes, Colonel Idere has described you as someone that is readily available for illegal activities. What do you have to say concerning this?
Good. Colonel Idere has always said that, but it is not true. My Lord, he said before this commission that I was a wizard, I could write anything, and that I took a jeep to General Sabo, and the jeep was worth 100 million. But when it came to time to be appointed the boss, he was a year and a month my junior. They left the wizard who could write papers, who could take jeeps with 100 million, and they chose this fellow with inferior intellect and inferior integrity. Thank you.
Do you have anything to say about Colonel Idere? Because he has accused you of illegality.
What we have here is human rights violation against some Chuma Zeribe.
We do respect, my lord. We are not. The commission is not investigating. But Colonel Idere was there when he said he stored bomb in his house, he stored ammunition in his house, that he took car as bribe. He said so many things. So he's here to clear his name as well. Allegations has been made.
You ask about that he was retired compulsorily.
We will ask him, my lord.
Well, that is more important to us.
Thank you.
What, were you retired?
I would answer that, sir.
All right.
Were you retired or dismissed from the army?
My lord, I'd like to start from there. And you will have to excuse me, sir.
Were you retired compulsorily?
Well, the answer is yes and no.
Can you explain?
Let me explain. My lord, there is a forged document saying that I'm retired. The commander-in-chief of the armed forces can see me in uniform as I speak. The chief of defense staff can see me. The chief of army staff can see me. So, if I don't have authority to appear in uniform, they should just send the military police after me. And this is what I want to explain. My lord, this matter was investigated and it was taken up to the chief of army staff, who is very clear now. Konedere has always been his counsel. They looked at the report and they found it impossible to prosecute. So they sent it back to the Director of Military Intelligence, and I was cleared by the DMI, who said, well, I have seen the report of this operation. We cannot proceed further. It is a pity you served under somebody who has no integrity. Please go back to your office. So I went back as Director of Intelligence Production Center.
You said the answer is yes and no. What is a yes?
Good. The yes is what I want to explain now.
That you have been retired. No, that you have not been retired.
Sir, so as soon as General Abache died, things changed around. Then I got a letter saying, well, go to Lagos Garrison Command for jurisdiction. This was on the 20th of July of the next year. They now reopened the case. So I got ready and went to the place I was supposed to be tried. And I met the president of the court. My lord, a week later, a very interesting letter, which I want to explain, sir, please listen to me, emanated from the office of the Director of Military Intelligence. Let me tell you what had happened. General Sabo had been retired, and an extraordinary officer, Colonel M. A. Dari, had been brought from abroad to be DMI. A fellow traveler with Colonel Idehene, whom he explained to be an intellectual, a certain fellow called Colonel Akeyemi, now wrote a very strange letter. But because I'm a professional, I didn't take the copy, but he said something like this. He said to the chief of army staff, this matter under investigation should not be investigated because Colonel Majeyogbe is an extraordinary man. He used the expression borrowed from the Americans, this officer has performed beyond the call of duty. Therefore, do not prosecute him. However, retire him. Wonderful letter. How can you write something like that? So, because they had arranged it, they now took it to General Bamiyi and said, well, sir, we have done what you said. Then General Bamiyi called the MS. This, I was not there. So please, I wasn't there, but I have been in the system. So they said, okay, put his name. That one said, what do you mean put his name? He said, put his name for retirement. That one said, what do you mean? There's a senior officer like you. He was the presidential commission. He said, I will tell Oga. Then the day I was supposed to appear in court, the documents are there in the army. 17th of August, the same day another letter came saying you are retired. Appear in court, you are all the letters came in one day and they are there in the army headquarters. So I now took the letter and I read it. He said, army council has met and has approved we should be retired. Which army council? Sir, the ministers of the army council are there. There was no army council meeting. What did they do? They did a very strange thing. When the army council met later, I was surprised that people can be so careless. They now put in the minutes, we retire this man because he do illegal duty. So council now approve. The council just rubber stamped it. Subpoena them, let them bring the minutes. You will cry. How can you be so careless to say army council is a rubber stamp? So this is why I'm saying that if you look at the document on the face of it, it gives a false impression of a retirement. But as the lawyers say, the man who signed acted ultra vires, and that document is null and void and of no effect whatsoever. In other words, it did not happen. My Lord, you know that better than me. It is a fake document. It didn't happen. In any case, when they now said go, because they knew that they were playing with fire, they now said, okay, you are retired.
What worries me from what you are saying, you are now asking us not to believe anything the army tells us. At least 90% of them may not be true.
Ask the army to produce the documents. This is the kind of thing they were doing at the time. Subpoena them, bring army council minutes. They lied there and they said, we have driven him away, you know. I am not tempting it. Ask the army to come and show the minutes of the army council. I could have taken it, but I'm a thoroughbred professional. I won't take it. They know, I read it. This is the kind of kangaroo thing they were doing.
Having said all this, have you been retired?
Well, the army says I have been retired and they now
hold it. The army says you've been retired.
Yes, sir.
Who in normal circumstances should retire you?
Army Council.
Army Council.
Yes, sir.
Army Council did not retire you.
The Army Council.
The Army retired you.
Army Council did not retire me.
But the Army retired you.
No, sir. Lieutenant General Isaiah Bamiyi.
Colonel.
Yes, sir.
I'm interested in what you said about your present uniform.
Yes, sir.
As far as a layman like me is concerned, the fact that you are in uniform presupposes you are still in service.
Okay, sir.
So, yeah, that's what I said. Where are you presently serving?
Thank you very much, sir.
Location.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yes.
When they gave me a letter, sir, I'm sorry, sir, I have to give you the opportunity to explain. I'm sorry. When they gave me a letter saying go, they were very careful. Number one, they said, please keep your ceremonial uniform, keep your service uniform, and keep your mess kit. So if there is an official location, you need to see me on October 1. I'm going to be in beautiful ceremonial dress. The army says, take it. That is the law. So they gave me this uniform and said, take it, your mess kit, your ceremonial dress, everything. So I have a letter signed by the army says, boy, you bloody good, keep it.
Excuse me. Assuming you are dismissed, will you be given the uniform?
No.
The question asked this. Not that your uniform is an issue. Where is your present location?
I have been retired by Lieutenant General Sir Bamiyi.
So you are retired?
Not by the army, yes, sir.
Although you are allowed to keep your uniform?
Yes, sir.
I see.
And I have a letter from the army. But let me also say one thing, sir. This is very relevant. Sir, please let me add this. In the letter of retirement, they said services no longer required. In the army council, they said he did illegal duty. Let me explain. The reason they did that is this. If they put in my letter of retirement that I committed illegal duty, they will be disgraced in court. So what did they do? They put services no longer required. And they wrote me a beautiful letter of service. Say thank you. You did very well.
We seek to stand out that, my lord. Excuse me. Come on, Abdi.
Yes.
Well, you know, this is a bit confusing for me as a...
And as a kangaroo thing.
Yes, person, but pathetic for me as a citizen, because I really find it very difficult to understand. And as the chairman said, two people or two generals or whatever cannot be telling the truth. Somebody is not telling the truth. And it's a pity that we have to choose whom to believe or whom not to believe. It's a bit unfortunate, but I guess for us as citizens, this is where we find ourselves.
The lawyer says, reps ipsa loquitur. The fact speaks for themselves. Thank you.
What's the last exhibit? 42. 22.
In lieu of
So when you are retired and left with your, are there some people who are retired and left with their uniform or what?
My lord, when you are dismissed, not only do they, oh, by the way, let me add an additional point. Just as a clinger, they now pay me over 90,000 naira every month. Thank you. Yes, over 90,000 every month.
Which would not have been if you are dismissed.
Yes, let me answer your question directly. An officer who is disgraced, his sword is broken, his uniforms are seized, and he cannot keep the rank.
Colonel,
yes,
let
sir.
Us put it in evidence. It helps your matter. I mean, yes. One, you are too much. Let's put it in evidence.
We'll mark it and give it to him to read.
You can read that.
Produce exhibit 23. Read it.
My lord, to whom it may concern, in lieu of certificate of military service, Colonel Olanipekun Majeyogbe retired. Colonel Olanipekun Majeyogbe was born on the 29th of March 1951 in Ede, local government area of Osun State. He was granted Director Service Commission on 26 February 1976 in the rank of lieutenant with seniority in the same rank and same date, and later converted to a direct regular with effect from 15th of March 1978. He rose to the substantive rank of colonel before he was compulsorily retired from service with effect from 17th August 19...
Read that again. Before he was what?
Compulsorily retired from service with effect from 17 August 1998.
Yes, continue.
Colonel Majeyogbe held a number of command and staff appointments throughout his years of service in the military. While in the service, the retired officer attended relevant...
While in service, the retired colonel... Go on. Go on.
While in service, the retired officer attended several relevant courses and performed creditably well. They can say that again with distinction. Thank you. As his certificate of military service is being processed, you are please requested to accept this letter as a testimony of his having served in the Nigerian Army pending the issuance of the document. This is for your information and necessary action. Signed,
Exhibit 23.
Glory.
Yes, to round up, do you have any other thing to say to assist this commission?
My lord, the council asked a question if I had anything to say about Colonel Dehere. But I thank God that I will resist the temptation. This commission is not set up for smear campaign or campaign of calumny. I was in the same unit with Lieutenant General Isaiah Abameyi as a captain. He was a major. General Sabo was a captain. General Abubakar was a lieutenant colonel. So I have known him all this while. Then I became the Director of Intelligence Production Center, which means that all the information in Nigeria comes to my office. I have a lot of information. I'd like to give credit, my lord, briefly, to the officer who even established the office, Colonel LKKRA. Fantastic officer. So it was easy for me to do the job. My lord, I would be descending to the level of most people you have seen here to now come and say, this is what Idehere is. Because this thing is for reconciliation. The police have a file. SSS has a file. So if they want to deal with him, let them go and deal with him. Two, I am now a man of God. I have forgiven everyone. I preach in the church every Sunday, say forgive, otherwise they will not forgive you. I met General Bamehi. I gave him a smart salute this morning. And I said, God be with you, sir. I forgave him in 1998 with tears in my eyes because I couldn't pray. As I tried to pray, the Holy Spirit told me, you are holding somebody down. I called my wife, pray for Ishaya Bamehi. So I'm not going to talk about him. Nemesis will catch up with him. Those who know him will deal with him. Glory to God in the highest.
That's all for him, my Lord.
Just an aside, did you watch AIT presentation of your evidence?
I did not, sir.
You did not?
I did not.
Well, I did. Yes. You know what they said?
No, sir.
They had a civilian Yemi Tokoya and a military Yemi Tokoya. Does that ring a bell?
Yes, sir. And let me answer that. You see,
that's what they said.
Good. I have to answer because you raised it. My Lord, some journalists are doing a dangerous thing.
You know Yemi Tokoya?
No, sir.
I see. Then
but I've heard
you
about it.
You understand the joke if you don't know.
No. I understand the joke, but I want to seize this opportunity. Some journalists are doing a dangerous thing. Generals are fighting generals. Colonel is fighting. Then the journalist who is trained to respect the truth and present facts begins to run his mouth. They are deploying money and marabou and juju. I am deploying the power of God. If that journalist gets caught in between, he will be smashed. But I have prayed for Gwenga Aruleba. They should sack him and employ Ogbon Sureni. Those are reporters. Fire the fellow and get him out of town.
All right. Are you born again?
Yes, sir.
That's all for you, my Lord.
Does anybody want to cross-examine?
Certainly, yes. Colonel, you have been sworn to tell this honorable commission the truth and nothing but the truth.
Yes, my Lord.
And you swore by the Holy Bible.
Yes, my Lord.
Please, can you take the Holy Bible? The Bible.
Well, it's not. Oh, okay, yes.
Could you read Proverbs chapter 9, verse 5?
Proverbs chapter 9.
Chapter 19, 5. Sorry.
You brought a Bible?
No, sir.
I see.
No, I have my Bible there, but this is the Commission's Bible. That is what has been helping me all this time. It's going to shame my enemies. Yeah, 19. Yes, sir.
19, 5.
19, verse 5. Yes, I have seen it.
Could you read?
A false witness will not go unpunished, nor will a liar escape. I believe that completely.
19, 9.
19:9. A false witness will not go unpunished, and a liar will be destroyed. I believe that completely.
Yes. Can you please look at James chapter 3 and read from verses 2 to 6?
My Lord.
As from now, anybody quoting them, but you must obtain permission from me before.
I thank you.
I like, because I want to take record of all the reverends who are appearing as lawyers and witnesses and so on.
Yeah, Father, I agree with you because I'm a graduate of the International Institute of... Yes. And I trained and I'm an ordained man of God. It's the best Bible college in the world. It's in Ikoyi, Redeemed Christian Church of God. Glory. Yes, what chapter, please?
James 3.
James chapter 3. Yes, verse?
2 to 6.
Verses 2 to 6. Yes, I read chapter 3, verses 2 to 6. We all make many mistakes, but those who control their tongues can also control themselves in every other way. We can make a large horse turn around and go wherever we want by means of a small bit in its mouth. and a tiny rudder makes a huge ship turn wherever the pilot wants it to go, even though the winds are strong. So also the tongue is a small thing, but that enormous damage it can do. A tiny spark can set a great forest on fire. Verse 6, and the tongue is a flame of fire. It is full of wickedness that can ruin your whole life. It can turn the entire course of your life into a blazing flame of destruction, for it is set on fire by hell itself.
Yes. As a man of God, Cornell, James chapter 3, verses 2 to 6. Yes, ma'am. You would agree with me now, having become a man of God, it is important for you to guide your tongue.
Yes, indeed, you're right, my Lord.
It will not be correct for any man of God to use his tongue with which he praises God and to also insult. Am I correct?
Absolutely, my Lord, you're right.
Very well. Now, having accepted to tell this commission the truth, did you receive any letter from the military secretary?
I don't understand the question.
Did you receive a letter of retirement from the military secretary?
Oh, yes, indeed.
Do you have a copy of that?
Yes, I do.
Please, can you be generous enough to show the commission a copy of that letter?
Oh, yes, I do. I am going to tender it because of what the chairman has just drawn my attention to, that I will not be under any liability, otherwise I would have said no. But I do have, please just give me a moment, I'll fetch it.
Is you, are we probing now, that is an authentic pastor?
No, my Lord.
Rights have been committed.
I just want to tender that letter and...
To show what?
I will stick to my commitment to be... petition specific, but he mentioned my name.
But you swore on oath to tell the truth.
Yes, my Lord.
The whole truth.
I only
and nothing but the truth.
I only want that
whether
letter.
Whether he's a pastor or not is irrelevant.
I will tender that letter and leave the others for address. He mentioned my name, and I think that letter will be relevant in the course of address.
Yes, my Lord. I have found a copy.
Please. My Lord, can I tender that document in evidence?
Then I hope I'll be allowed to read it.
Very well.
Good.
Before you read that, were you at any time recommended by the legal department of the army for trial?
Glory to God. Yes, indeed. And I must explain.
Thank you very much.
Yes, I'd like to explain.
Your counsel will lead you to do that. You were once recommended,
yes,
for trial.
I have not concluded my answer. My Lord, Exhibit 21.
Man of God. Please, you have
mark
answered.
It, exhibit 24, you ask, and let him read it.
Oh, God. My Lord, I read exhibit 24. Headquarters, Nigerian Army, Department of Military Secretary, Bonikam, Victoria Island, Lagos. 17th August, 1998. Compulsory retirement, Nigerian Army officer, Colonel Olanipekun Majeyogbe. In pursuance of paragraph 11, subparagraph 2C, of the terms and conditions of service of the Nigerian Army officers, 1984, The Army Council,
yes,
hereby approves the compulsory retirement of Colonel Olanipekun Majeyogbe, number 5535, from the Nigerian Army with effect from 17th August, for services no longer required.
not for any offense committed. One, two, he says, officer is authorized to retain his rank of substantive colonel, which is too junior now, but officer is entitled to a certificate of military service. Nigerian Army pay office to take the following actions. Pay the officer all his entitlements up to the effective date of retirement. Recover fully from the officer all indebtedness to the federal government of Nigeria and any of its agencies in accordance with the current regulations on the recovery of indebtedness. HQ LGC is to take the following action. Decate the officer, less his ceremonial dress, his service dress, which I'm wearing, and his mess kit. Recover from him all forms of arms and ammunition. Recover from him his Nigerian Army identity card and other military control items loaned to him occasionally in the course of service. Ensure that the officer completes the Nigerian National Security Declaration forms attached, which must be forwarded to the Department of MS with his identity card. Officer will complete 6 copies of NA form A453 attached, which must be forwarded to Directorate of Military Pensions. Ensure that the officer submits 6 endorsed passport photographs to Officer's Documentation Department. Occurrence will be published in the Federal Government Gazette and Army Orders in due course. Signed, S.B. Said, Major General, Military Secretary, Army. Thank you.
That will be all for him, sir.
Any other cross-examination?
Majeyogbe, please.
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Colonel Majeyogbe.
Yes, sir.
Congratulations for being a man of God. I'm congratulating you, sir. Please cast your mind back to the second half of 1996. What was your rank and where and how were you deployed?
Second half of 1996.
1996.
I was the director. Intelligence Production Center. That is the hub of activities there. That's the last bus stop for intelligence process.
What was your rank?
Full colonel.
Full colonel?
Yes.
As at September 1997.
Yes.
What was Steve? As at September 1996, what was Steve Colonel? What was Colonel Steve's rank?
He was a lieutenant colonel and one of the boys working in the department. Yeah.
And how was he deployed?
He was, these boys, what were they doing? Okay, he was General Staff Officer 1.
General Staff Officer 1?
Yes.
Great. Very good. As a senior in rank and appointment, I mean, you were senior in rank to him.
He said so. That's very true. 1 year
you said
and
so.
1 month.
You said so.
1 year and 1 month.
Good.
That is true. The records bear me out.
Where were you when Colonel Denyere was being appointed as the acting DM?
Glory.
Based on merit.
You are asking the question and answering it. I was the director of Intelligence Production Center. You asked me where I was. You asked the person who made the appointment. Not me. I would not know. I am a zombie. You put me there, I do the job. So if you think that he was appointed on merit, you ask the person who made the appointment. I don't ask those questions.
Okay, you were senior to him in rank. He was given an appointment over you.
Yes.
He now became your boss.
Yes. And why, I said yes,
why,
sir, to
why,
him.
Why were you not appointed, being the senior in rank? Why you
me not? Lord, what kind of counsel is this? I did not make the appointment.
Okay.
Ask the person who made the appointment.
My own
is to obey instructions.
Colonel Majeyogbe, I put it to you that no one would have considered you to be the acting DMI or even considered you for a post in DIA or any other external appointment because of your known record of involvement in illegal duties.
Very good. He who alleges proofs. We have had this sing song since July. Illegal duty. Not one has been proved.
Now, Colonel Majeyogbe, there is usually a weekly staff conference.
Yes, indeed.
Head, good. Correct. Do you remember on one of such occasions when Colonel Dare rebuked you as the officer who is involved in illegal duties?
Good.
Do you remember, yes or no?
Yes, I do.
Thank you very, very much.
Good. But I must explain. Me,
no,
Lord.
No, you have answered. You said yes, you do. You do remember.
You see, you have answers. I was not rebuked.
You said
and
yes.
And I regret that Colonel Dare is being dragged into this.
Colonel Majeyogbe,
Council.
You have just said yes. You remember that you were being rebuked in one of such meetings.
Colonel, don't drag Colonel Dare into this. You see.
Do you also remember?
Me, Lord. You see, you ask half questions and you don't want answers because you don't want the
Colonel
truth.
You have
please,
yes.
Can you please learn to pronounce?
You
if you
yes.
call me Majeyogbe, I will not
I'm
answer.
Asking you
that is not my
question.
Name. Please, you're
remember,
a Nigerian.
Do you remember also when Colonel Frank Omenka rebuked you also on an illegal duty you were involved in?
That is a lie.
Around Tinkan Island.
That is a lie. Colonel Frank could not
yes
have rebuked
no,
me. No! Colonel Frank could not have rebuked me. He was my junior. He's still
you.
My junior. He will always remain my junior.
Thank you. Are you aware that arms and ammunitions are highly controlled items in the Nigerian Army?
Thoroughly so. Very carefully controlled.
Thank you very much. Are you aware also that no arm or ammunition may be issued, may not, arms and ammunition will not be issued without due authority?
Absolutely so. You're right.
Thank you very much. Are you aware that arms... In June 1997, were you on an official assignment to Sierra Leone?
Yes, indeed. Many times. I don't know which one you're talking about. I was commander of the task force, undercover operations of Operation Sandstorm. I was the president of the international panel which investigated the coup of 1996. I mean, I was the task force commander, anti-terrorist operations. So please ask your client which one he wants to find out.
Now, Colonel Steve, the DMI, the acting DMI, in that year, at that particular time,
yes.
1996, when we were on official assignment to Cameroon, Sierra Leone, thank you very much, I'm sorry, to Sierra Leone, authorized in writing, and gave you 3 AK-47 rifles and some ammunitions for that assignment.
Which one?
To Sierra Leone.
I was in Sierra Leone so many times. First, to investigate a coup.
I'm talking about 2nd June.
Oh, 2nd June.
Yes.
Okay, yes. June. I was undercover operations commander, task force.
And you duly authorized.
Operation Sand. Yes,
You signed.
Yes, indeed, I signed.
Thank you very much. Did you return the weapons as required by army regulations to the arms store by the time you came back from Sierra Leone?
No.
Thank you very much. Colonel Majeyogbe,
no,
excuse me,
please.
I put it to you.
Before you put it,
I put it to
let
you that
me explain.
I put it to you that you illegally kept those arms and ammunitions you brought back from Sierra Leone.
Good.
You knew the right process.
Thank you.
To return it back to the army. So the arms store in the army, you did not do it.
Good.
You have said you
Council, I do not blame you. So let me explain now. I have a right
you
to explain.
You have answered. You have said
my
yes.
Lord, can the commission help me? You ask a question. Let me answer
did
the
you
question.
Get, I'm asking
so
you
what happened was
we
this.
We have something called re-examination.
Okay.
Now, Colonel Majeyogbe. You signed the pass and movement data. You signed the pass and movement data for the team you sent to Ihiala before they left for the illegal operations, right?
I am not aware.
And movement data in the office, DMI office, before the team you sent to Ihiala left. Did you? Right?
Yes, I did.
Thank you very
much. And I've admitted in evidence and I've accepted responsibility absolutely unconditional, total.
Thank you very
much. I said I signed it and I accept responsibility for it.
In that pass, you stated that the team had 30 rounds of ammunition, whereas you actually gave them 60 rounds. Is that correct?
I'm not aware of what you're talking about.
Is it correct, yes or no?
I said I'm not aware.
Major Adeka, who carried out an investigation at that time, is here.
You see,
to testify.
Yes.
Are you aware, yes or no?
The reason that I'm choosing not to answer your question is that you are trying to be clever by half.
My Lord.
Yes. If you ask the question, when you get the explanation, The guy who is briefing you knows that it will
answer
be shut down.
Answer the question. Are you aware?
Aware of what?
I mean, okay, I'll ask you the question again.
Yes, ask the question.
I said you signed a pass.
Yes, he did.
You
I
said
did.
Yes, right?
Yes.
Good. In that pass, you stated that the team had, you gave the team 30 rounds of ammunition.
Yes.
Yes. You actually gave them 60 rounds.
Well,
I
signed a pass giving the men 3 Kalashnikov rifles.
You have said you signed a pass before. Did you? Okay, carry on.
Now, I signed a pass giving the men the rifles and the ammunition. I don't really know what you're talking about now. But
I'll repeat myself.
Yes, but listen to me very carefully.
In that pass, you stated that the team had 30 rounds of ammunition, whereas you actually gave them 60 rounds. Is that correct?
I did not actually give them 60 rounds.
So
if you want an explanation,
no,
you'll get it.
Yes or no, you have said to?
Yes, I did not actually give them 60 rounds.
Thank you. Did you get any written authority?
Did you give? Or
did you get? Did you get any written authority?
No.
To issue this AK, 3 AK-47 assault rifles for that illegal operation?
No. No, no, sorry. For that?
You said no.
No, 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 no.
Kone Majeyogbe.
You squeezed in
you
the word illegal.
You are I did not squeeze you into any difficulty.
No, no, no.
I mean, you answered.
Ask the question. You said for that illegal operation.
With due respect
to the commission, I believe. Excuse me.
Just ask the question.
This is cross-examination. You can ask any question. I am craving the indulgence of the counsel. I want you to ask the question and let him answer, please.
Thank you very much, my learned colleague. I'm asking your client the witness question. He's supposed to respond. I'm putting it to you to answer yes or no. So it's left for you to elect to say yes or no.
Good. Simple. And explain.
No explanations. Yes or no explains everything because
okay,
we don't want to waste time about this.
And you spent so much time bringing irrelevancies to this commission and you don't want to waste time.
You have said yes, that you did not get any written authority.
Oh, I did not. My boss at the time gave me instructions and I moved like fire. Yeah, he is here.
But when you went to Sierra Leone, you got a written authority from your boss.
No,
at
I
that
did
time,
not.
You got a written authority.
No.
He issued you arms and ammunition and you signed for it on the 2nd of June, 1996. You just said so. You did say so.
I don't think you have
But you
facts.
Did not get any written authority
you
from
don't.
The same boss. Kone Majeyogbe,
you are
mixing, a man of God.
You are mixing
Tell
the
this
facts.
Commission the truth. Nothing but the truth.
You don't have the facts. So you are mixing. If you ask the question.
Let's proceed.
Do not
Let us proceed.
Yes, go ahead, please.
I believe you have read the petitioner's petition.
I dealt with that petition so thoroughly that there are not many people who don't know now. Point by point. Thank you very much.
In the petition you received,
yes.
In the alleged petition you received,
yeah.
That prompted, that made you to carry out that illegal operation at Ihiala, what were the allegations made against Chief Shuma Nzeribe that prompted that operation? What were the allegations in that petition you received?
Good. I am not going to answer the question the way you have put it because you are talking about an illegal operation and I am not aware of an illegal operation. So if you say for the operation in Ihiala, I will answer. So can you please let me help
for
you
the,
with
anyone you put it right on, just tell us.
They say anyone. How can I answer anyone? Okay, fine. I will answer the question to the best of my ability. There was an operation that was carried out. It was my responsibility as the commander of the Special Task Force against Terrorism. All right? So I gave the instructions and I received instructions from my boss. And I'm standing by the instructions that I gave.
My question is, what were the allegations that made
oh,
you...
good.
The allegation against Shuma Nzeribe that made you to carry out that operation. What
good.
Were these allegations?
Good. I had already repeated this. You don't want to waste the time of the commission. I already explained this. My Lord, at that time, I was Director of Intelligence Production Center.
What were these allegations on a Majeyogbe? Go straight to the point. One after the other. Yeah. What were the allegations?
Good. So Nigerians have been writing petitions. So the petitions came, and it said that the bomb blast that occurred in Onitsha was the handiwork of Chief Chuman Zeribe, a certain Mada Fokwa, and some other people like that, and that they were going to carry out other bombing operations. Yes, that is the summary of what was in that letter.
The summary, you can, I mean, I'm telling you to tell me the content, I mean, the allegations, when you have summarized it. Thank you. My Lord, I seek to, I apply to get a copy of Captain Dulaga's statement he made before this Honorable Commission. Exhibit 2, my Lord. Please give it to the witness. You have a copy of it?
Yes, we have the official copy.
Please read, take a look at it. Read page 2, the paragraph 4 of it.
That is the top paragraph. On 14 July, is that the one?
Yes, 14 July.
On 14 July 1997, Monday, the DIPC called me and directed that I should prepare for an assignment either to Sierra Leone or to Hiala in Anambra State. He eventually decided on the latter and showed me a petition that was written by a certain Victor Okafor. Then I didn't know that it was Ezeogo. The petition alleged that Marcel Chukwumanzeribe, Fortunatus Dike, and Bonaventure Madofokwa were Nadeko agents responsible for various killings, bombings, and terrorist acts in Nigeria. It also alleged that Marcel Chukwumanzeribe had an assembly of military equipment used to produce explosives in his uncompleted building in Ehiala. I was tasked to arrest them along with any exhibits.
Please, can I have it? Thank you. Majeyogbe.
Majeyogbe, please.
You have told Kone, thank you, Kone. You told this commission that the petition read that Chief Chuma Nzeribe and Bonaventure and some other people were the people responsible for bombings in Nigeria. That was what you said.
Yes.
But the leader of the team you sent to Hiala on that operation has said, I said something here that you did not say. You are telling lies to this Honorable Commission. Do you realize that? You are. Let me read it to you. It says, it also alleged, you said only one phase of that petition.
You asked me to summarize it.
No, I did not ask you any second phase. I asked you, what were the allegations?
To recite a document?
You cannot recite, but you should remember, you said you summarized, and I was asking you, be explicit one point after the other, but you
in
decided
summary,
to go by summary.
In summary, you asked me to recite a document, a director of intelligence
now,
production center,
like I told you,
who receives hundreds of petitions every day. I will now memorize one.
It also alleged, according to Captain Dulaga's statement, it also alleged that Marcel Chuma Nzeribe had an assembly of military equipment.
Assembly, not assembly.
Good, thank you. An assembly of military equipment used to produce explosives in his uncompleted building at Ihiala.
So what? So what is the question?
You have told this commission lies. I'm putting it to you that you did say
you are entitled
for this commission now.
You are entitled to your opinion. You asked me to summarize a document.
It is your opinion.
It is your opinion. You are free. You are counsel after all.
When and where exactly did you receive this petition? When did you receive the petition?
In my house.
When? In your house. When? I mean, what time? What year? And the date? When?
I cannot remember exactly, but I know that it was in my office, and I remember that it was in July.
Not, you said your house. Not house again. It's now
you
an office.
You have been talking about this house and house. This is what Konedene did and failed in 1997. Thank you very much.
Please,
Counselor,
also tell this Honorable Commission the date you received this petition.
I cannot remember exactly, but it came before the 14th July with hundreds of petitions, hundreds of reports, Army, Navy, Air Force, Police, SSS, prisons. You don't know, you don't understand the kind of job I was doing from everywhere in this country.
So what date was it handed over to you? you cannot remember the date on the petition, what date was this petition handed over to you?
It was handed over to me on or about sometime between the 6th and the 10th of July.
Sometimes between the 6th and
yes.
the 10th of
yes,
July.
Yes, I can't remember, but I know it was July.
Sometimes you cannot remember, but you know it was July. Sometimes between 10th and 6th and 10th. Thank you, Cornel. Cornel, please tell this Honorable Commission all the actions you took from the time you received this non-existent petition to the time your team, led by Captain Dulaga, left for Ihiala.
You just ruined your client. My Lord, I hope you give me the opportunity to talk because you asked for it. So you listen carefully.
Remember also that he painted a picture of urgency.
My Lord, this petition...
Last week, he painted a picture of urgency.
You've asked a question. Let me answer the question.
There is no doubt that he investigated.
Yes.
No doubt Nzeribo was arrested. Then the other man set him free when he became DMI. These are already in evidence. I don't know the purpose of this questioning.
My Lord, the
purpose
of
that he wasn't arrested.
My Lord, the purpose of this questioning is to show that he did not get any official authority from the direct. He did not get any official authority from the Directorate of Military Intelligence under the hands of acting leadership of acting DMI Stephen Idenri.
Put that straight to him, and we will go on.
My Lord, last week he alleged that.
No, put it to him that he didn't get authority to go on the investigation.
Can I answer your question now?
Yes.
Good. This petition came, and I went to my boss. Sir, we have this petition. What do you want me to do? There are two ways this can be handled. I can minute it to you as having received.
What do you mean by that?
Sir?
You have already gone to send people to Ihiala.
No, sir. He said she has to go to the beginning and explain the procedure. She asked the question, sir. That what steps did I take? And those are the steps I want to explain to her. She asked the question, so.
She was insinuating that there was nobody who authorized you.
Good, so let me now answer the
and
question.
And you said, no, you were authorized by whom?
By Colonel Idenere. Huh? But if I explain
that's
now.
That's all right then. It depends on whom we believe.
Yes, so then good. So I went to my boss.
All right. He said he authorized you.
Okay, fine.
He said he didn't authorize you. Well,
okay.
We will resolve that somehow.
Yes.
You said.
But he got a phone call from the people that went.
You said.
They spoke to him.
Kone, he didn't reauthorize you.
Yes, he did.
Was there any written?
No, there was. He didn't write one letter.
When he authorized you to go to Sierra Leone in 1996, was there? You have said there was a written authority.
That was an international operation.
There was no written authority.
Yes. You have in the army. You have standing orders, you have particular orders. You see, it's a pity that you don't understand the military system. If it was a military lawyer now.
Colonel, I put it to you that Colonel Idenri did not authorize you to carry out that.
That is why we are in this problem. He's a coward. He gave instructions, he took cover. I gave instructions, and I said, I'm ready to take it. We don't want men like this in this country. It's a dangerous man. People who will give instructions and then take cover. This kind of guy can ruin the army. I hope those soldiers will take instructions from their bosses, not minding what Idenere did. There are more officers like me than Idenere.
Colonel.
Yes, my Lord.
I'll be right to say that according to you and according to Captain Dulaga's evidence, you went to Ihiala to raid an uncompleted, unoccupied building.
That is very true.
Thank you.
Very true.
Where arms, ammunition, bombs, and all those other equipment, according to your alleged petition, were kept. Did you go with any sniffer dogs, or detective?
I'm sorry, I don't mean to be rude to the council. There was no sniffer dog. We don't use sniffer dogs in military intelligence. We don't use sniffer dogs. So, council, I'll pray for you. Go ahead.
Okay.
You need prayers to ask the correct questions.
When Captain, I want to ask you this question, just be direct. When Captain Dulaga and his team returned on the 18th of July, 1997, what are the things he brought back from that operation.
Thank you.
They brought some cables, batteries, contractions, things that, you know, they were not bombs. I've explained that. You know, you just want cables, used batteries, and things, some yellowish substances, very funny substances, you know. I have already explained that to the council, I mean to the commission.
Progress, please.
I mean, what, okay, where were these items recovered in Shuma in Zeribe's house?
Well,
was it recovered? Was it dug?
Remember, we are discussing human rights abuse on Shuma Zeribe.
Zeribe.
Not on this witness.
Well, my lord, I have to ask him all these questions because I'm trying to establish a point, my lord.
Establish what?
The
we
point
have the evidence of the colonel. We have his evidence. We choose and pick. When we ask for 10 hours, that wouldn't do our job. We will know whom to believe by considering the whole evidence.
In your evidence, you claim that the items dug out from Chief Shuma in Zeribe's house were not explosives, right?
Counsel, the commission, I said there were no bombs. You don't know the difference between bomb and explosive.
Right, is it right? You claim that.
I did not claim that. You appear to forget this very easily. I said not a single bomb. It was emphasized here, the commission can remember. Not a single bomb. A bomb and explosive are not exactly the same thing.
But the petition read, the alleged petition you received, read that Chief Shuma Ezeribe and other people were accused for planting bombs. They were the people responsible for the spate of bombings
so,
in Nigeria.
So
at that
I will
time.
Wait for the thing to explode before looking. Counsel, please help us.
She wants to say something.
They allege.
My lord, at this juncture, Colonel Majeyogbe, you don't have to be so patronizing to counsel. Just answer questions. My lord, please.
My lord, I apologize. Madam, God bless you. God bless you. Bless you real good. Thank you very much. God bless you. Yeah, let's.
Well, Colonel, if that is the case, there were no explosives, why then did you detain him at all?
Good question. Somebody was arrested with some funny substances. And the officer came and said, look, we brought these guys. We have these things. I said, okay, fine. We had a petition alleging that they had bombs. Indeed, my lord, the captain said, sir, I suspect that this thing is fictitious. I said, good. I will not explain my own opinion so as not to influence you. But this guy has been arrested. Take his statement. Let us examine the things. Then we know what to do.
Was that enough to detain him, Colonel Majeyogbe? Was that
absolutely
enough?
Absolutely so.
It was enough to detain him.
Yes,
there were no explosives found in his house. But
if I had released him, they would have said he caught somebody with bomb and released. I said, keep this man. Take his statement. Let us examine the thing. You say that is not enough.
Colonel,
you are not.
Do you own a BMW car?
Oh yes, Lord.
Thank you very much. Thanks to the Lagos of Ezeogo. You have earlier told this Honorable Commission that when you received the non-existent petition, there was need to react urgently, right?
Yes, I did. And I just said it again. And I'm going to say it again if you ask me.
Was there any state of emergency in Nigeria as at 1997?
Glory. I don't think concept.
Because you gave an example.
My Lord, with Zulu War.
Was there any state of emergency in Nigeria as at 1997? Witness, you gave example with the Zulu War.
Okay, you have finished your
yes
question. Can
no?
I answer?
Answer.
I'm not going to answer yes or no. I am going to answer the question. My Lord, our soldiers were dying virtually on a daily basis. Along Western Avenue, Bonny Camp, everywhere. Bomb was exploding as far as Onitsha, Ilorin Stadium. You are asking whether there was a state of emergency. A formal state of emergency was not declared, but the Directorate of Military Intelligence took the most senior professional in the Corps, Glory,
and
make him
a
task force
commander. A formal state of emergency was not declared. Thank you very much. From the time you received that petition,
yes,
and from the time you allegedly briefed the acting DMI, how long did it take you to launch the operations to Ihiala?
Good. The acting DMI said before this commission that he briefed the Chief of Army Staff on the 19th. So at least
He said that here before this commission, and that he had a rumor on the 21st. On the 23rd, he set up investigation to investigate what he had on the 19th. He said it before this commission, and then the rumor of 21. I went to the DMI immediately, and I told him, look, we have this way. What do we do?
My question is this again.
Yes.
How long did it take you to launch your operations to Ihiala?
The operation was supposed to leave on the 15th. I don't know why the DMI went. So I told the guys, and they have admitted in evidence, that you cannot go because DMI is not in. So they left on the 16th.
Thank you. Take a look at Dulaga's statement again. Please give it to him. Where is it? Please. Sorry. Paragraph 4, please give him to read paragraph 4. And the first sentence in paragraph 5. Paragraph 4. And the first sentence in paragraph 5. You stop in 1997.
How much longer? 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours?
My lord is about...
But I don't know where we're going to.
Please read paragraph...
My lord, I read in obedience. Out of due deference to this commission. On 14th July 1997, the Director of Intelligence Production Center, and I was the one at the time, called me and directed that I should prepare for an assignment either in Sierra Leone or here in Anambra State. He eventually decided on the latter and showed me a petition that was written by Victor Okafor. Then I didn't know that it was Ezeogo. The petition alleged that Marcel Chukwuma Nzeribe, Fortunatus DK, and Bonaventure Madua Fokwa were Nadeco agents responsible for various killings, bombings, and terrorist acts in Nigeria. It was alleged that Marcel Chukwuma Nzeribe had an assembly of military equipment used to produce explosives in his uncompleted building at Ihiala. I was tasked to arrest them along with many exhibits. I proceeded to Ihiala with 5 soldiers at about 8 o'clock on the 16th Wednesday.
Thank you.
On arrival there,
on the 16th Wednesday.
Yes.
From 14th to 16th.
This is the third time he read that thing.
My lord, he said, you say if there was state of emergency in Nigeria, how come it took 3 days before the team went for Ihiala?
My lord, I just said before this commission that there was no formal declaration of state of emergency. But the conditions under which we were operating, our soldiers were dying every day. And she suddenly began to complain about 3 days lapse. I don't understand you, counsel. I'm sorry.
Colonel, who was that petition addressed to? The petition, who was it addressed to?
The petition was submitted to the Directorate of Military Intelligence. And
Who received it? Who was it addressed to? Was it addressed to you? Or it was addressed to the acting DMI? Or HQ NIC?
The petition was brought to the Directorate of Military Intelligence. I don't know what trick you're trying to play now. But all I remember, listen to me carefully. And I'll explain again. Excuse me, sir. Give me the opportunity.
Witness, my question is this. Who was it addressed to? Was it
I
addressed
cannot.
To you? Was it addressed
I
to
you? I must stop this. We have evidence that the petition was written. Is it in dispute? Who it was addressed to is irrelevant. We had evidence that the petition, we had evidence that they went to Ihiala. Isn't it? We had evidence that they went to Ihiala. We had evidence that they searched certain places and made a report. You had evidence that Chukwuma Nzeribe was arrested. We have evidence that he was later released, then rearrested. All these are in our record book. I don't know what we are fishing.
Okay.
He has put it to him. He said no. You have put it to him that he went on his own frolic. He said no, he was sent by your client. Then I said, it's for us to choose whom to believe. He said he didn't send him. He said he sent him. There's no way you can resolve it by asking questions. You can let us look at the other antecedents and say, because of that, believe this man, don't believe this man. Finish. It's a question for address, not cross-examination address.
Colonel, where were you when acting DMI ordered the release of Chief Ezeogo and also ordered the arrest and detention of the officers he sent, if you claim that he was aware?
I don't understand the question.
I mean, where were you when the acting DMI ordered the release of the petitioner,
yes,
and those you sent to Ihala?
Yes.
He detained them, he ordered their detention.
Yes.
Where were you? Did you react? If you claim that
good.
He was aware, did you react
now,
in writing? Did you react
now I understand your question.
Against his actions?
Have you landed? Now I understand your question. I got to the headquarters and Lieutenant Colonel Francis Eromosele Okosu said, sir, we have a problem here. I said, you don't have a problem. He said that is something that is going on, and the acting DMI directed that some people should be released and you ordered the operation. I said, you kidding me? So I stormed into his office. I said, sir, what is the problem? He said, you know, somebody come here. And he talks, saying, be Navy man. That thing, maybe say the thing not be so you be. So I said, make it then go. I said, come on now. You cannot do that. You are my boss, but I'm your senior. What he should have done is to call me. Please don't interrupt me, please. You asked a question. I said, what he should have done is, as a senior man, to say, you, stop. And I will stop. Because you say, you go, I go. He said, okay, no worry. Make you come, they go do your exam. I go sign the paper. Come on, look. Look. Look.
You have not answered my question. My question is, did you react in writing?
My lord, she's asking whether you reacted in writing. I stormed to the man's office.
You have said, excuse me, you have said that. You have said
the operation
is illegal.
I did not react.
I said the operation is illegal. You said the operation is legal.
It's so very legal.
Did you react in writing to make it legal?
I think we should stop this theater. It's going... The chairman has already given you a hint. First of all, I think the case is very clear. You can split the case into two. Namely, after the detention of Ezeogo here, if I understood Conedere's testimony, once he was detained here by the police, and the suspicion was that Chuma had caused his detention, Ezeogo then used his connections with the military, which is why the allegation is that this chap simply said, okay, fine, there are bombs and explosives in Ihiala. I'll go and sort it out. And the allegation is that the man simply collected his people, armed himself, and went off to Ihiala on a frolic, so to say, on his own. Now, and the chairman has made it very clear, by now we should know whom we are to believe. So this is not something you're going to establish by any form of cross-examination. I think the facts are already in evidence, and you should at least credit us with a bit of common sense that we should know by now whom to believe. So why don't we simply close the matter at this point and move on, please.
Thank you, my lord. I just have very few questions to ask.
Okay. After all this,
Konemojegwe.
Yes.
You said.
Yes, my lord.
You said he did not write Brigadier General Sabo's project.
Glory. That is made so clear. Everybody in this country now knows. I didn't write it.
My lord, that is all for the witness.
Tell me that nobody is intimidating her. She wants to go, she can go.
No. I hope you are through with your question. I mean, we don't want to give the impression that anybody is being intimidated here.
My lord, I'm not through, but it's okay. Where I ended is okay, my lord. Major Adeka is here, who carried out the investigation.
Yeah.
He is to testify on the remaining aspect of this.
Okay, week. If you say so.
Colonel, just for my...
Yes, my lord.
Yes, many of us, because you dramatize this thing about bombs were exploding and soldiers were dying here and there. Yes, sir. Do you have an idea about how many soldiers died under this funny bombing? Because on evidence, I mean, evidence has been adduced here that indeed the bombings were induced within the military itself. But have you an idea about how many people died? Good. How many soldiers died?
My lord, I don't have the exact figures, but I know that the soldier died in Ekeja cantonment. I know that along Ojuelegba, when the explosion took place, one soldier died and some were injured. And I know that some policemen were injured in the convoy of Colonel then, now Brigadier General Bubomarua, retired. I know that the bomb exploded in Onitsha. So I don't have all the figures, but bombs were exploding. And that is why indeed this task force was set up. And I was said, look, said you will be in charge as the task force commander.
What about the Kaduna explosion?
But thank you very much.
Culture. Sir.
The bombs were exploding everywhere. So they said, okay, you are a very good chap. Can you take charge of this for the intelligence corps? And I took charge. And suddenly they say, oh, we didn't send you.
Any other cross-examination?
Yes, my lord. I just have two questions for you.
All right.
Yeah. Colonel Majeyogbe.
Yes, my lord.
You have you indeed told this commission that you accept responsibility for the orders you gave Captain Dula and the other officers junior to him. That is to say, you accept responsibility for sending them to Ihiala to investigate the allegations made by Ezeogo. Now, who gave you instructions?
Colonel Stephen Idehere.
Now, did he ever accept responsibility for this instruction he gave you?
He did not. We would not have been here today.
Now, is it possible in the military setup and in the intelligence setup of the military for a unit of officers led by a captain to undertake an operation which will last about two, three days without the commander knowing about it at all? Is it possible from your experience?
It is not possible.
Why do you say so?
My lord, this was an operation that involved men and ammunition, and we had the suspicion that if it was true, and we didn't know whether it was true, they could even die in the process. And that is why I gave them the telephone number of the commander in Enugu, the telephone number of the acting DMI, three telephone numbers, and I gave them my own. And I told them, when you get to Oweri, report to the commander there. It was a very dangerous thing. So they could not have just gone on their own. And thank God when they called, they spoke to the acting DMI.
Now, you also have testified here that indeed what was recovered at Ihiala were not bombs.
They were not bombs, my lord.
Can you take a look at Exhibit 2? I think the list is attached there. Next to that's the report submitted by Captain Dula. Please, can you read the list of the items that were recovered at Ihiala?
Oh, yes, indeed, my lord. This is not very clear, but I can. 25 kg bag of potassium nitrate, 3 wet batteries, 1 packet of American Eagle pistol cartridge, 5 live rounds of 7.62 millimeter ammunition, 2 shotgun cartridges, 1 live round of 10 live rounds of different assorted ammunition, half a bag of yellowish substance, some quantities of black chemical, 4 wired locally made explosives. The others are not very clear. Copper wire, some nonsense.
Please read it.
1 roll of copper wire, some quantity of carbide.
It's all right. If you can't read some, the commission will read it. Now, there is no mention of any bomb there.
Not one, my lord.
Now, please, do you recall the investigation conducted into this matter by the security group? Now,
I did.
If you do, was there an instance where a letter allegedly written by you when you were in detention was intercepted? And if it was, what was contained in that letter?
Yes, my lord. When this matter broke and news was all over the place, there is a young man by the name of Lieutenant Colonel Ali Yakasai, who is my very close friend. And I know that he will be very disappointed. So I wrote a letter to him saying, look, Ali, I didn't do anything wrong. Please believe me. I was acting under the instructions of my boss and have a duty to protect my boss at any cost. In any case, don't forget that Colonel Edehere was appointed by General Sabo. So please wait until it is over. I will come and tell you the truth. And I sent it to Colonel Yakasai. Unfortunately, they intercepted it.
And used it as evidence?
Yeah, I used it as evidence. So they said, even when he was writing to somebody and he didn't know that they will intercept it, they intercepted it and found he was saying, please don't believe them. This is the truth.
Please, during this investigation, were you at any time confronted confront each other with Colonel Edehere?
Oh, yes.
Please tell the commission what happened.
So when it became clear, because I had said, I am the one that did it and I'm ready to take whatever punishment, they now said, maybe there is a truth in this. So they brought Colonel Edehere. Said, yes, what do you know about this operation? He started lying. He said, me? I don't know this man. This and that. This is a stupid man. Then the colonel told him, this man is your senior. He said he didn't care. You know, he said he didn't care at all. And in fact, he's going to deal with all of you and all that. He got very angry. He became very wild. You know, and then he kept denying and said he was going to storm out of the place. He was going to deal with everybody. We knew what he was talking about at the time because he was very close to the chief of army staff. And I was not. I don't run around seeing officers. My job speaks for me.
But he was also subject to...
He was interrogated. In fact, my lord, let me seize the opportunity to explain. When the report got to army headquarters, General Bameyi and Colonel Dene were very close. There's nothing wrong with that. The report said, charge them. If you recall Exhibit 21 now, you'll be sorry for this country. They now went to the lawyers and told them, listen. Write that this fellow is the only one that can be tried because he admitted. Since Edehene did not admit, it would be difficult to try him. What kind of law is that? And there's an antecedent. Let me explain why the lawyers behave like that. That matter is before this commission. Colonel Peters was arrested. When he was to be tried, a court was set up. The court said there is no evidence, we don't have documentation. The lawyer, the judge advocate, God bless Major Okeke, said, look, this officer has not been properly charged. So they set the officer free. General Bama, you retired all of them. Judge, lawyer, president, he fired everybody. That is true. Please. It is true.
My lord, I am cross-examining this witness. And I don't think there is any limit my learned friend can place on my right to cross-examine him. I didn't limit his cross-examination. He is very fond of, tampering with cross-examinations of other counsel. We have to be professional, please.
So as I was saying before, I was rudely interrupted.
In any case, hold on. Now you. Did you ever report this incident to General Sabo when he was at War College?
No.
Were you at any time instructed to do so by Colonel Edehere?
Yes.
Now, do you remember when you were asked to do that?
Yes.
When was that?
On the 23rd.
He told you on the 23rd?
Yes, sir.
Now, when did you really get a pass to travel to Kaduna for the exam?
He authorized the pass the same day. Milo, let me try to describe it.
Please, stick to my question. When did you...
24th.
The pass was authorized on the 23rd,
yes,
on
sir.
The 4th.
Yes, sir.
When did he approve the pass?
No, he will not sign. He will just approve in writing So okay. It is a clerk who will now, so okay. The approval was on the 24th. So I was legally free to travel on that day.
That's right.
Because the DMI has said so.
Now, when did you now get to Kaduna?
I got to Kaduna about 26th, 27th.
And while in Kaduna, you got information that you, the acting DMI, wanted to see you. Am I right?
Yes, indeed.
Now, there was a telephone conversation between you and the acting DMI.
Yes, sir.
Can you narrate to the commission what really happened on the phone?
I got a telephone. I was conducting exams for young people. And I was sent by General Bami. He selected the best officers himself. So I started getting all sorts of telephone calls. A fellow that I would not like to talk about because he's ugly, this colonel, he mentioned him. Men of God should try to be careful.
Please, just stick to your story.
The colonel phoned me and said, you should come back to Lagos. So I said, listen to me, colonel. I came here on the orders of the DMI for a job of the chief of army staff. I am not coming. He said, okay. Then one Lieutenant Colonel Mande, who was later the military administrator of Nasarawa State, now came, sent another note. You are wanted in Lagos.
What happened on the telephone? The conversation, I'm asking.
So I now came to the headquarters, and there is a colonel who was there, now a general. So I now came to the headquarters, one div, to talk to Colonel Idehere. What is the trouble? Hello, what is the problem? Everybody is calling me. You know I cannot live here because what I'm doing here is superior. He said, then he started speaking big English. No word in Anna, that matter. I beg go, look, just try you here, we'll go settle the matter, this and that, you know. So I said, okay, please stick to your story. Don't worry, I'm not going to betray you, even upon the pain of death. You are my boss. He said, okay, no worry, no mind then. I didn't know that he now sends people to say, go and get him. Thank you, sir.
Now to Nzeribe's matter proper, really.
Yes, sir.
Now, what really happened from my own perspective is that Ezeogo, Victor Okafor, sent you and your men, well, sent the DM, the military intelligence on a wild goose chase to Ihiala. They sent you on a false alarm to Ihiala. You arrested Nzeribe and brought him to, and locked him up. Eventually, well, your Dula.
Are you giving evidence?
No, sir, I'm summing it up so I can ask him a question. Now, Dulaga arrested Nzeribe and one other person, brought the exhibits, he was locked up, and up to the 23rd, there was no problem.
Not at all.
What really sparked off the problem on the 23rd?
A certain naval captain now came to the headquarters. I wasn't there, but this is what Conede and himself told me. I said, look, this matter you are investigating, there is more to it than meets the eye. I do not know why he suddenly panicked and then called Major Adeka, who had just come from signals, and asked him. He's a signal officer par excellence. He had just come to the call. He now said, investigate now and bring a report now. So the investigation now said, the headquarters does not know. How would he have known? Thank you, sir.
Now on the 23rd,
yes, sir.
You testified that you reported to Colonel Adihere in his house.
Yes, sir.
Now, when did Dulaga report to you?
Dulaga, that was if he didn't report, he called me on the phone to say they have come. That was on the 19th.
And then you reported to, when did you report to Colonel Idehere?
Colonel Idehere, I don't know where he went. So he had the habit of roaming around, you know. But I saw him physically and we sat together in his living room on the 21st. And he has admitted that here before this commission. He said now, it was a rumor, but at least he admitted it.
Now, in the end, you are not aware of the second detention, So it is you who actually, it was on your orders that Nzeribe was detained the first time.
Yes, I gave the order.
That's right. But the second time, it wasn't on your instructions.
I didn't even know that he was rearrested.
Thank you. That's all I have for him.
Any questions?
Just a few questions, my lord.
Yes.
Colonel, please, in accepting responsibility for this whole action,
yes.
Do you equally agree with the fact that the alleged planting of bombs in his house was a frame-up?
Well, as the investigations were to reveal, There is no way I would have known before. But even the captain...
Please, answer him. Don't go on a wild goose chase. Was it a frame-up?
I don't know what you mean by wild goose chase. Please.
Please answer me. Was it a frame-up? The bomb or explosive planting, whatever, in his house?
The investigation was not concluded. But if you ask me as an expert in the field, I would say that was the direction in which it was going. If it was not released, I believe we would have come up with the view that this was probably a frame-up. No. I believe that completely in my mind.
Because what I'm asking you is that the officer you sent, Captain Dulaha, he came here, he testified. He tendered his bid too. He said he was calling you on phone, and that when he came back, he told you that something was wrong. He smelled a rat.
Yeah, he told me. That is true.
And you still felt that his detention was justifiable.
Absolutely so.
When the officer told
he
you.
He is a now, that's okay. Captain. It's captains okay. Don't give instructions to Colonel. I have more experience than
no,
he
you
has.
Sent him to investigate. You trusted him. He's an officer. You sent him, and he came back. He told you.
So he will come and give me instructions.
Hold it. Now, it's be 21.
He won't give me instructions. Thank you.
Now, on issue of authorization.
Yes.
It's be 21. You are aware of it.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Now, you said there was an investigation conducted by who?
By security group, Nigerian Army Intelligence Corps.
Very good. Not the one conducted by Major Adeke.
That was a funny thing. It was
okay,
a
very good.
Thing.
Now, that's the issue they report.
How would I have known?
Ask me.
I do not know.
So, you mean there was an investigation and but no report?
Why don't you ask the person who all that is? Please don't ask me things
no,
I didn't do.
The one done the by I the security done, group I'm talking about. Adeka will just come and give brief.
I said go and ask the director of military intelligence. I never made it to that appointment. Go and ask them. Don't ask me.
Don't shout at me, please.
I'm not shouting
at you.
You
are a witness here. Just
yes.
Listen.
Yes,
now,
I'm a witness.
SB 21. You can see it.
I can see
have
it.
Have a look at it.
Thank you very much.
SB 21 is a legal advice. You agree?
Yes, it is.
Now, in respect of the investigation, the second investigation conducted by the security group.
Oh, so you are aware there's a second investigation? Yes, it did. Yes.
I'm following your evidence, witness. Please
yes.
Take it coolly because yeah, you are going out
coolly.
Of
thank
your
thank you lessons. Very much. Yes,
ask
go ahead.
Him to look at SB 21.
Yes.
He has it. Then ask the question.
Yes, exactly. That's 21. What I'm leading him. It's a legal advice. That's SB 21. Is that?
Yes, it is a legal advice.
Now, read paragraph A of that advice.
Paragraph A? Paragraph A is reference. I don't know what you mean by...
Paragraph A, down, the body of the legal
oh, the
advice,
body, you thank you. Colonel Majeyogbe, that... He said, Colonel Majeyogbe, that from the evidence, his testimonies amount to admission, so he's liable. I've admitted 100 times here.
To read, not to dance.
Yes. That from his evidence, his testimonies amount to admission, so he's liable.
Yes, very good. Then paragraph B.
From Colonel S. Idehene, he now said, from the evidence, there is need for an independent investigation, an independent witness to corroborate the testimonies of Colonel Majeyogbe, as Colonel Idehene has controverted the claim made by Colonel Majeyogbe. So he cannot be tried.
No, thank you very much. Now, let me take you back on the issue of legality. Give it back to him. The legality or otherwise of this petition.
Yes.
What is the standard practice when you receive a petition alleging, like in this case, explosives or bomb planting or whatever? What is the standard procedure within DMI? Does it go straight to the Director of Military Intelligence, or does it pass through you or some other officer?
Good. When petitions are sent by posts, all petitions go to the Director of Military Intelligence. But in this business, information comes from all sorts of sources. So, the ones that come by post go to the DMI. Others, people come by word of mouth. Others,
in this
people,
instance,
yes.
Where did this petition go directly? The petition.
Let me go back a bit. I was told by word of mouth, and I said, please put it in writing, so it was brought back to me.
Who told you word of mouth? Who?
Chief Victor Okafor.
Okay, he told you about that Chuma Zeribe planted, listen, that's the late Ezeogo. He told you that there was a bomb in his house.
Yes.
Then you told him to put it in writing.
I said, put it in writing, and then we forward it to the appropriate quarters.
Now, when you received the petition,
yes.
Did you register it?
No.
You didn't?
No, I did not.
My Lord, that's all for him.
Yes, any other re-exam?
No re-examination.
Thank you. It's all right then. I think they said they don't.
Where?
You want to be discharged, you want to still stay there?
I'm sorry, my lord.
They have no more questions for you. Any more questions for him?
Not at all. The counsel says, my lord.
Except that it's a bit intriguing. Why you chose to wear a uniform today?
Good. Thank you very much, sir. Colonel Idehene sat stood in this place. They drive him for army. They disgrace him. If you want to defeat somebody like Idehene, you have to defeat him decisively. Now, since he has told you what, the shame and come out. Now, disgrace. 99% of officers of the army live by compulsory retirement. It is a routine procedure. If you're too old or there is no further appointment. He was insisted on painting me black.
I say, why did you decide? It's your own decision. Why did you decide to wear uniform today?
Today.
Last time you didn't wear uniform.
Yeah, to show that he's a liar.
No. He said you are retired. You are retired.
No, he said, now disgrace. He spoke Pidgin. He said, now disgrace. They said we don't want you. He said, they said we don't want you. Come out there. I have no problems with the army at all.
That uniform will show that they want you.
No, it will show that if I'm not entitled to it, somebody should have arrested me. I've been here for 1 hour now.
Thank you.
Yes.
You are discharged then.